Well, good morning. Good morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church. We're glad you're here today. All is right in the world. Baseball has started. Neither one of our teams have started very well. But the Red Sox the other night, Carlin, there you go. How was it, 19 innings? Like a 6.5 hour baseball game. There's nothing better than that. So hopefully our teams will start doing better. I heard a bunch from Aaron Perry's fiance yesterday. He's a Detroit fan, and they were at the game. And all right, Joel, I see. Yeah, and the Tigers beat the Indians. And they beat them 2 in a row. So there we go. But it's spring, so we're all happy. Few announcements from me this morning. The first one is our annual Pentecost service with all the other Presbyterian churches is Sunday, May 24th in Newcastle High School in the auditorium. Please put that on your calendar. That's one of the highlights of the year when all the Presbyterians get in one room and worship God. That's pretty great. Next one is mark your calendars. Our church picnic and worship in the park is Sunday, June 7th. At Pearson Park in Shelter 5, the same place we've been the last few years. Mark your calendars. There's going to be a lot more information coming on that. VBS is coming June 15th through the 19th at the Newcastle Christian Academy. We're going to be working this year not only with Glenmore Presbyterian, but Northminster is joining us this year too. All three churches joining forces for VBS. We still need lots of volunteers, so if you can do that, you can see Wendy Hutchison. She will hook you up as a volunteer. We need bunches of them. So talk to Wendy. She'll tell you everything that we need in VBS. Next thing, youth group tonight at 5:30. Parents of youth, we talked about mercy this morning in Sunday school. Please have a conversation with your child about mercy today at some point. That would be awesome. Or even better, show your child some mercy today. Oh, pretty great, huh? So youth group tonight, 5:30. That's it for me. Now we have a minute for mission from Chad Ubrey.
I just wanted to take a second and draw your attention to an announcement in the bulletin about the World Vision Workday. Brett mentioned it last week in the announcements. It's coming up in 2 weeks, the 25th of April, Saturday. We're going to go down to World Vision Center in Sewickley and pack clothes. We sort shoes, sort clothes in different sizes, pack them up, and then they get shipped out all over the world. It's a really neat experience. We've gone a couple times before, had a good group of people going. So I want to make sure everyone is invited to join us. We're going to meet here at 7:30 on Saturday morning at the church. Our work time is 9 to 12. They're pretty, stick to a pretty tight schedule. They have a crew in the afternoon as well. So at 11:45, they tell you to clean up, and at 12 o'clock, you're out of there. So it's a good 3 hours. We get a lot done. And then we're going to share some fellowship probably in Cranberry, Wexford, stop and have some lunch on the way home. So we're going to be carpooling down. Everyone is welcome to join us. It's age 11 and up, so if there's any youth out there that want to join us, we'd love to have you as well. So if you could let me know if you're interested in going. I have to let World Vision know our numbers here in the next week or so you can see either myself or Sandy Earle. Let us know that you're coming. And next week there will be an announcement in a bulletin as well. You could fill that out and give it to us as well so I can let them know. So hope you plan to join us on the 25th, packing up some clothes. Thank you.
Who am I? my ever wandering heart. And not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. And not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. The voice that calmed the sea would call out to the rain and calm the storm in me. And not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are.
And join in the call to worship as printed in the bulletin as well as projected on the wall. We need your presence on the long road, Lord.
The road between where all is hopeless and the place of resurrection.
Like the disciples walking the road to Emmaus, we are in need of your company.
Jesus, walk among us in your risen power so that we recognize your presence.
Let us worship our risen Savior.
This very room. closer walk with thee.
Like the disciples on the road to Emmaus, we struggle to recognize God in the everyday journey of our lives. Trusting that Christ will transform the brokenness that lies within us, let us together offer the unison prayer of confession, which is printed in the bulletin. Lord Jesus, like the disciples on the Emmaus road, we are often so overwhelmed that we fail to recognize your presence. And we are so focused on our own lives that we do not create the silent spaces which allow us to hear you. Open our eyes that we may see you in all that we do and wherever our journey may lead. Through your forgiving love, help us to trust in your victory over sin and death, that we may live in fellowship with you and each other. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Continue your own prayers of confession in silence. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them. For the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. As God has forgiven us, let us show one another forgiveness by offering a sign of Christ's peace.
Have a seat, and a kid or kids who aren't down here already, come on down. This is your time in worship. All right. Question for you today. Have you ever heard something that was so exciting, made you excited, that you wanted to tell somebody else? Yep. Raise your hand. So exciting, it made you so excited that you wanted to tell somebody else. Raise your hand. That's it? Like three of you? Never been excited before? Okay. Today I'm going to tell you a couple things. We're going to play a game. To play the game, all of you kids in the pew are perfect, okay? Don't move. So you're good. You're good. But Will, I need you to come over here near Naomi. There you go. And then Maggie, I need you to go over by Tyrone. And let's have Emily at the very end. Okay, so you're in one long line. All right, here's the game we're playing. I'm going to tell Will something that's so exciting that he's going to tell Naomi, who's going to tell Madeline, who's going to tell Claire, who's going to tell Cole, who's going to tell Ethan, blah, blah, blah. Okay? This is called telephone, all right? But you just have to tell the next person what you think you heard from the first person. And then we'll ask Emily at the end what she heard, and she can tell everybody what Will said. Right? Okay, no problem. Okay. You ready? All right. I have to turn off my mic for this. All right. Ninety. Okay. What was the message, Will?
Martha Shannon is 98.
All right. Yay, happy birthday. We're going to be celebrating one of our most wonderful members here, Martha Shannon, after church day, who's going to be 98, right? It's coming up. All right. But what did we say, Emily? 90. So it wasn't quite the same, was it? Oh, it's exciting. I'm excited, aren't you, Martha? Yeah, it's worth telling somebody. Yeah. All right. Sometimes that happens. All right. We're going to do another one. All right, yes. Monkey standing on the end. What was it, Will?
Monkeys are dancing on my head.
All right. Well, this is a little closer. This is a little closer. All right. So this is the last one. You guys are getting better at this. All right. All right.
playing.
All right, Tyrone, what was it? Okay. Ah, Emma, what was it?
Jesus has risen from the dead.
All right, yes. That's exciting, isn't it? That's exactly what we're going to be talking about today. So it's a whole season of Easter, not just one day where we get excited and have pretty flowers and nice extra music and all the rest. This season, we talk about Jesus being risen from the dead. But just like you guys saw, we all understand. Sometimes when we're telling things, especially great things like birthdays or even silly things, we get them kind of monkeyed up, right? You don't quite say them right. That was the closest one of them all, and I could see even to Tyrone, he got it. It was just a sweet little girl who kind of got it off a track a little bit. Let's have a word of prayer together. Holy God, we thank you so much for raising your son from the dead, for giving us hope. And every day, whether it's dark and cold or sunny and warm, that we have hope. Thank you for this season of Easter when we remember you. Help us all to be people who are excited about talking about you and why it matters that we love you, that you are risen from the dead. We pray all of this in Christ's name. And all God's kids said,
amen.
Thanks for coming down, guys.
Yeah.
So good, God is so good, God is so good, He's so good to me. He cares for me, He cares for me.
As you opened the scripture to the disciples on the road to Emmaus, open our hearts to hear your word and what you have to teach us today. Amen. The New Testament scripture lesson is from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 through 27, which can be found on page 1125 of the Pew Bible. That very day, the two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all his people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to the death and crucified him. But we had all hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had seen a vision of an angel who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see. And he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that prophets have spoken, Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all scriptures and things concerning himself. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us pray together. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, Lord, thou who art our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, last week we remembered the open tomb and the women who boldly went right in. They encountered two men who were most likely angels, who asked them a question. What are you doing? Why are you searching for the living among the dead? Then they returned with excitement to tell the disciples all that had happened. And the faithful followers of Jesus, the disciples, they jumped to their feet and they began preaching resurrection. Well, not exactly, right? Peter ran to the tomb to check it out, but his response wasn't preaching resurrection either. He went home and marveled at all that he saw. That's how the first part of Luke 24 ends. That's how we ended our text last week on Easter Sunday. Some of you probably saw this. If you haven't seen the first episode, you can look at it online. Last Sunday, NBC began this new show, AD. The Bible Continues. I believe it's on at 9 o'clock. And the first episode began with Jesus confirming before the Sanhedrin that he was the Messiah. Of course, then Caiaphas charged him with blasphemy. Peter betrays him. He's tried before Pilate, and he's crucified. Then Judas commits suicide. It's a bit graphic, but then it was. It was. Later, the show depicts his mother Mary reminding the disheveled disciples of the prophecy that he had told them, that in 3 days he would rise again. Now, that's not actually in Scripture, but it adds to the story. Remember that, too, while you're watching a show. It's not always exactly accurate, but it doesn't take from it. It adds to the story. Yet, unlike many made-for-TV movies, especially during Holy Week, this one's not done. This has just begun. Tonight's installment is about what happens after he's risen from the dead. Today's scripture text, if you will, is the original from which the show derives its inspiration. Who knows? Maybe they'll do the Emmaus Road. I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. As we've sung, in this very room, there's quite enough love and joy and hope for all the world. But it's not because of the size of who's in this room, and although this is a good group today, the size of people in the room would have been last week, right? We almost got 200 folks here. It's wonderful. It's not because of that. It's because in this very room is the presence of Jesus Christ. That's the reason. So today, we remember that God's story continues with a resurrection appearance, which is unique to Luke's gospel. No other gospel has this, the road to Emmaus. Now, who knows what it all really looked like, what it was all like along that dusty road? We don't know. But thanks to this picture, which I saw in childhood, this is what I always imagine. How many of you have seen that picture? Yeah? That's the one I imagine when I think of the road to Emmaus. So Jerusalem was about 7 miles from Emmaus. Think in terms of walking between here and, let's say, Neshannock Falls. It wasn't a whole day's walk, but it wasn't just over the hill either. It would have taken some time to get there. And you can tell from the text, they aren't in any hurry. They're taking their time. One of the man's name was Cleopas, or Cleopas, however you want to say it. The other? I don't know. We're left guessing who that is. Why not picture yourself as that other person along the road to Emmaus? Remember, it's Easter evening, and you're out for a walk, and you're talking about all that has happened. Can you picture it? Luke indicates that the two were discussing Jesus' life and death as if it had just happened. But it hadn't just happened. When the walk took place, it had been 3 days. You probably can't remember what you ate for breakfast 3 days ago. But the point is that because of the significance of the event, though it had been just 3 days, or rather it had been 3 days, they were still talking about it. Because of the significance of the event, though it had been 3 days, they were still talking about it. Then Jesus shows up out of nowhere. Text doesn't say where he was, whether he was alongside of the road or appeared between them or jumped out of a bush. I don't know. We have no idea. All it says is that Jesus drew near and he went with them. But though that's unusual, it is. It's kind of weird. This stands out even more. They don't recognize him. No idea who he is. Many suggestions have been made as to why this is. Maybe they were walking towards the sun as it set, and they couldn't quite see. Maybe he was wearing some sort of disguise. The post-resurrection body didn't quite look the same. I don't know. Or maybe they just couldn't see. They had bad eyesight. Seriously, I've read about all these in commentaries this week. They're interesting ideas, but they all miss the point. Jesus kept them from recognizing him. He was in control then, just as he is now. He kept them from recognizing him. He wanted them to speak openly about all that had taken place without them knowing that he was walking with them. That's an interesting part of the story, isn't it? Because it speaks to us about the nature of God. He doesn't coerce our belief. But in time, he gives us room to have our eyes opened to who he really is. That's next week's text. Just a little preview. On the walk, he intentionally asks open-ended questions. They're obvious. Just kind of puts them out there. What is this that you're talking about? And then later, what things that happened? After the miracle of Easter morning, he wants to check. He wants to see what we're saying. What are we saying? After the miracle of Easter, what are we saying? What'd you tell others last Sunday night if you had a chance to talk with family and friends from other places or neighbors, whatever, about Sunday morning? What'd you tell them? Did you talk about the nice weather? It was one of our nicest Sundays in a long time. Thank God, right? Did you talk about the beautiful flowers that were here in the sanctuary? Or our wonderful brass quartet that played? Or the full room, or nearly full room, or the passion of the preacher? I don't know. Maybe you did. Did you talk about Jesus? I wonder. If you were there as the total stranger walking along the road, what would you have said? If you were the unnamed walking partner, what would you have added to the conversation? Something about Jesus? Maybe the other details would have gotten your attention, that the sky had turned dark. Oh, it was amazing, like we would have about weather last Sunday. Or maybe something else that was different that wasn't always there in a crucifixion. There was an inscription above the cross. I don't know what that was. I couldn't read it from afar, but somebody said he's the King of the Jews. Maybe you would have talked about that. Maybe you wouldn't have said anything for fear of the unknown. Who is that visitor from Jerusalem? Maybe they were going to turn you in to be crucified next. Maybe that's why the text doesn't say who the other man was. We don't know. But the bottom line is, both men were so focused on their own issues of power, of control, of loss, of bewilderment. Text says they were sad and they stopped, right? Sadness sometimes can just stop you in your tracks. That they couldn't have seen who Jesus was or what he had done for them anyway. In a way, if you were, they were blind, but not in a physical way, in a spiritual way. They were totally blind. They were speaking of a mighty prophet, not a Messiah, of him not having redeemed Israel, of the women's far-fetched stories, of angels saying he was alive, and someone, don't miss this, other than themselves. They, of course, were referring to Peter. Someone other than themselves going to check it out. They're disappointed, the disciples. They're doubtful. Consider this. How did disappointments and doubt still derail our Easter-sized faith? Think about that. How did disappointments and doubt still derail our Easter-sized faith? The disciples described Jesus as a prophet, powerful in word, that's significant, and deed, the word of God and God in flesh. Now, we now realize that he was much more than a prophet, but in his day, being called a prophet is actually high praise. It compares him with the likes of Israel's greatest, Moses, Elijah, Elisha, prophets. Think about this. Another aspect to consider is that the disciples expected Jesus to be the one who was going to redeem Israel from her enemies and to set up a kingdom of God right there on earth. Redeem in the Greek text is the verb lutru. Its basic meaning is the fee, by paying the ransom. But the word used here, not the same word, is an extended meaning of liberating from an oppressive situation, set free, and rescue. So not just paying the penalty, but liberating, setting free, rescuing. So while we may think of Christ's work as a spiritual redemption from sin brought about by the cross, paying the penalty, Cleopas and his friend are thinking rightly of a military redemption, of taking over. Since Israel's free, or rather wants to be free, from Roman occupation. They wanted freed, literally. And now, that's impossible, because Jesus is dead, or so they think. Our disappointments are real, aren't they? So were theirs. Our doubts are real. So were theirs. Verse 21 says they had hoped for something different. Can you relate? They had hoped for something different. The words here, had hope, mean to look forward to with a confidence about something coming to pass. The once bold disciples now had their hopes dashed. He's dead. All that for what? They were thinking. If you're a men's basketball fan for either Kentucky Wildcats or Wisconsin Badgers, you might have had your hopes dashed. You would hope the season had ended it a little differently. If you're a Penn State or Nebraska fan, you're just glad the season's over. How can you relate to your hopes being dashed? Maybe you lost a job. A close friend moved away. A medical report you got wasn't good. A spouse broke your trust, or a child broke your heart. Our disappointments are real. So were theirs. Our doubts are real. So were theirs. Now what? Jesus has been crucified. He's dead. Some revolution. Maybe you've been there too. What do you do when your hopes are dashed? You talk it out? You pray? You clam up or deny it? Do nothing? The women told the man who spoke with Jesus on the road to Emmaus the good news. The women told the men who spoke with Jesus on the road to Emmaus the good news. The women had told the men who spoke with Jesus on the road to Emmaus the good news. They wouldn't allow themselves to believe it. Has that ever happened to you? A wise friend, a spouse, or a co-worker, they gave you the advice you needed to hear, but you were unable to act on it because, I don't know, something in you is broken. It seems like nothing can heal you. You just won't allow yourself to believe. Life can seem overwhelming from time to time, but friends, never forget, we serve a risen Savior. Amen? Disappointments and doubts don't have the last word. The death of Jesus, it's not the end of hope. It's only the beginning. It's only the beginning. Redemption is real in the resurrected Lord. And that would be a great way to end an upbeat place, but there's more to the text, isn't there? No matter how conflicted we may feel, sometimes there's no way to sugarcoat what needs to be said. Jesus can only listen so long before you can look back at it. In verse 25, he calls the men what they are. The women had already told him, "You're fools," he essentially says. He rebukes them. This picture of a stern, straightforward Jesus is encouraging to me. Maybe you like it too. As someone who often deals with people in need all the time, maybe you do too, it reassures me that even Jesus has a point where he stops the men's doubts and delusions from continuing on. You're fools. Stop. I encourage you to look this up later. It's not spiritual at all, but it'll give you a good belly laugh. Look up on YouTube later Bob Newhart's counseling session. If you haven't already seen this, this is fantastic. So there he is, Bob Newhart, in this skit, pretending that he's the counselor. And in walks a woman who's claustrophobic, right? And he says, "I only charge $5 for the first 5 minutes. And then nothing after it." "Wow," she says, "that's fantastic." It's like, "I assure you, we can take care of this all in 5 minutes or less. Oh, by the way, I don't make change. So you have to be here for five." It's great. So then when she asks for his advice about the fear of being buried in a box, he pauses. And then he looks at her and says, write these two words down. "Stop it!" And she's totally losing it, like you probably are right now. And what do you mean? And he assures her, he's simply telling her what she needs to hear. Thinking about being buried in a box is awful. Stop it. But then they haven't gone the whole 5 minutes, and so she sits back down and says, "Okay, well, I also have an eating disorder, and I also am destructive in relationships," and he stops her and he says, "All right, some more advice for you." "Stop it!" And then the ending is even more hilarious. You'll have to look at it. But friends, in many ways, we overcomplicate things, don't we? Our excuses for not fully believing in our resurrected Lord are no more than an adult version of a childish tendency to blame others for our problems. It's not my fault. Or a fear of the unknown. Whoa, whoa, whoa. What might happen if we change things up a little bit? I don't know. World might come to an end. Or becoming whiny when we don't get enough sleep. Oh, geez, yeah. Right? This is the same thing our kids deal with. It might seem a bit harsh, but so let me put it another more spiritual way. Was it not necessary, this is what Jesus said, that the Christ should suffer and enter into glory? This is what was meant to be. Fools, wake up, he essentially says. So there you are. You're there, remember? Walking down the road with Cleopas and Jesus. What excuses are you given as you walk alongside him? What's your reason for not fully believing in an Easter-sized faith? What's getting in the way? You might have, I admit it, legitimate hurt and concern or mental and spiritual conflicts that cause you to be slow of heart. That's also right in this text. But the good news is, he's still walking beside you. He's still there. He prompts your answers by asking, what does he mean to you? What does he mean to this church? For over 2,000 years, friends, God's story has continued to be shared, and over the last 216 of them, they've been shared by you all, people of this church, in Newcastle and beyond. So the open-ended question for us this morning is clear, isn't it? Does God's story continue through you? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. Let us continue in worship by going to God in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you, just as the choir sang, that we can lean on your everlasting arms. We thank you for your word today, which reminded us, not unlike the earliest disciples, that the conflict then, as well as now, is real. And that the things that get in our way of having an Easter-sized faith are ours to deal with. But that none of them will completely overcome us, were we to simply continue the journey with you and allow the words that you do say, the ways in which you tug on our heart or direct us, even if we can't hear literal words like they could, to reorient our lives. We know, Lord, this can be daily. And for some of us, this can be even more often than that. We give you thanks that the power of your Holy Spirit makes that possible. We pray for those who are not there yet, who don't get it or won't get it or can't get it. And we pray for our most clearly sanctified among us who do get it, who are sharing it, who are living it. Help them to continue on, to stay humble, but to find hope even in the most difficult situations. Help them to continue to be our inspiration, Lord. We thank you for this church, for all it's meant, for all it still means, and for all it will yet mean. But not because we sit in a beautiful building, listening to good music and encouraging each other, celebrating a milestone of a wonderful woman's birthday, but because you, in addition to all that good stuff, you are in this place just as you are in every place of our lives. You make it possible for us to have hope every day, for us to overcome our difficulties and despair, for us to hear agents of health and healing. Thank you for all of those who make a difference in our lives. Our parents, our friends, co-workers, counselors, healthcare advisors, all of them. Help us to see you in them, and for us to be more and more like you, even as we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. God's story continues, because it's God's story. You who were created, and even before you were created, in God's mind, you who were born, you who were raised, you who were given and are still given life, you, all of you, you have an opportunity to live this day into the calling which is yours, found in Christ Jesus, our resurrected Savior. It doesn't mean that even as he leads you, as we just sang, that it's easy. No, Jesus was pretty clear about that. The wide, easier way where the most go isn't the right one. But that straight and that narrow path, it can be bumpy. It can be rough. It can be bewildering. It may be that way this day. So be ready. But know, lest you're overcome with fear, there's nothing to fear. Nothing to fear, for death itself could not hold our Savior. And so even if your day ends today, we've sang about it twice, actually, with the end of your life, what we none of us, especially Americans, want to think about too much. Even if that happens, because of where your faith is, you're good, as the kids would say. God give you the strength to go the way, even as he leadeth you this day. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be yours today and every day. Amen.